Joining us on the role of digital in the attention economy is the Chief Revenue Officer of Prime Media. He has 24 years of entrepreneurship experience with an MBA with merit from the University of Birmingham, UK. Currently, he is the Chief Revenue Officer at Prime Media Broadcasting and the Chief Entrepreneur Officer at Eden. He also provides the service of growing businesses to Fortune 500 businesses by defining a bespoke growth playbook and helps them implement it to achieve a turnaround and ultimately grow. Please welcome Lindile Xhoko.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. How are you guys doing this morning? Good. Well, as the voice has said, my name is Lindile Xhoko. I'm the Group Chief Revenue Officer at Prime Media. And today, I'll have a conversation with you about the role of digital in the attention economy. But I'll get into more details in terms of exactly what is the attention economy. But first, I'll actually share a statistic with you that says 85% of communication and adverts fail to reach the attention threshold required to make a meaningful impact. That now speaks to what the attention economy is. So the attention threshold is an indication of how much attention or how long you hold a person's attention within a specific time. And that's because there's a lot of proliferation of devices, cell phones, tablets, screens, televisions, and all of that, but also social media and digital. There's a lot of that out there, so it's very difficult to hold a person's attention because they've got access to so many information pieces. They could be watching TikTok, they could be watching news on the app, they could be watching television, radio. There's so much content and information that's out there. And Kantar did the study. In fact, they released the study in July this year at the back of the Lions Awards in Cannes this year for the communications. And what came out was that the attention threshold is merely 8 seconds, right? Merely 8 seconds in terms of that attention threshold, but there's a lot of communication and content that's going out at people, and it's failing to land. Imagine 85% of that failing to land. So therefore, it talks to how do you actually construct content that'll actually make an impact. So, and I'll share a little bit of exactly how we aim to do that. I published a book last year, which was called The Young Entrepreneur's Playbook, Using Failure as a Shortcut to Success. My next book is going to be on this topic of decision impact, right, when it comes to the attention economy. The title of the next book is going to be called Decision Hacking, The Science of the Conversion. And it takes into all of the research in terms of what gets a person across the line when it comes to making decisions, and all the decision points they've got to make across that point. At Prime Media, we're doing all of that work using AI. So we've built a data lake using AI to say communication out there, what is the appropriate channel for specific types of communication, and then how do we get a person to make the decision that is best suited for them so that they can get the best outcomes as possible, so that we facilitate that as well. But taking a step back a little bit, we then thought, because we've changed strategy, and the context of us changing that strategy, of us evolving with the times, of keeping up with technology, is on the basis of this. So what you know us to be is we own 4 radio stations, which include 947, 702, KFM, Cape Talk, as well as Eyewitness News. Added to that, we've got the widest network of outdoor inventory in static billboards as well as digital billboards. And in all of the retail malls, we exist. And I'll show you a glimpse of all of that. And then going back to the topic in terms of the role of digital in the attention economy, when it's so difficult to hold someone's attention, what is it that we can do as an organization to get there? In the context of why we then are adopting much more of the digital strategy is because of this. When you look at Africa as a whole, it then says that the digital economy is projected to get to $712 billion by 2050. But if you look at it today, it's not insignificant either, because it's currently sitting at $115 billion in 2022, and it's still in its infancy. So there's a lot of potential that's going there, and we're seeing digital disrupting traditional mediums of communication. And hence, you have to add digital to how one packages communication there. One, in the platform itself. Two, in the data and analytics of how you deliver communication. And three, in the value-value proposition of how you package communications out there as well. Which then, in how you create that last part that I talk about, which is the creator economy, which is essentially what we are, which is a content creator. That creator economy is estimated to be at about $20 billion today. And Africa should exponentially be able to benefit from this if you look at the makeup of our continent, because we are a creator continent, so we should be able to leverage on this huge upswing of the creator economy, of the digital economy, and then be able to take advantage of the attention economy. But I want to share a couple of statistics with you in terms of in 2022, which are the sectors that have grown by communicating better in this day and age. So if you look at the top growth categories in 2022 year to date, we've got financial services, which has a resurgence coming out of COVID-19 pandemic. We've got media promotion has grown quite exponentially as well, followed by telecommunications. Telecommunications, for example, had a bumper time during the pandemic. You would have thought that post-pandemic they would struggle, where most of those clients would let go of some of those technologies they would have procured because of work from home. But an interesting trend was that they're actually not. They're still keeping on to that. And the reason, according to the study that we've made, is because of a change in lifestyle. Because they've gotten accustomed to a certain way, they are now holding on to those things. Hence, telecommunications is growing as fast as it's growing still. Then the fourth is self-promotion and competition. It's followed by retailers. And the forecast in terms of retailers, they've had a good run post-pandemic. And now, as we enter October, November, December, that's also forecasted to grow massively when it comes to the impact that they're going to make. So post-COVID, these are still going to ride out in terms of the areas. Government as well, and I see there's government people in the room, have fared well in terms of, because they needed to communicate aggressively to people during the pandemic, and therefore post, they need to also keep their constituents up to speed with certain things, and therefore growth there in that area as well. Followed by professional services, entertainment, because consumption entertainment is largely different, and it's facilitated by digital. Then the automotive sector, which took a big knock during the pandemic because there were chip shortages, there were inventory shortages, but now they're coming out of that slowly, and therefore they need to grow and get back to where they were pre-COVID times. And of course, understandably, at number 10 is online shopping, because our behaviors have changed in that now, because we know that the delivery systems, your Zulzi's, your Checkers 6060s are there, they make our lives more convenient. So online shopping has grown quite aggressively as well. When you then look at the sectors that are still below 2019 levels, we see mining and manufacturing still under pressure. We're seeing electricity, we understand why. We see gas and water, we see and construction, we see trade still under pressure, we see catering, funny enough, still being under pressure. Accommodation and hotels are still under pressure. Transport, storage, and communication. But those sectors that have actually far surpassed pre-COVID levels is, as I've said, finance, real estate has boomed, especially in the Western Cape and the coastal regions, and business services. Agriculture, because food consumption has gone up, forestry and fishing, and personal services and government in terms of those services. The requirement is absolutely there, and that's quite interesting to know. Therefore, what is our approach in this attention economy as Prime Media? What is it that we're doing to keep up with the times as well as the consumption trends of consumers as well as businesses out there? So we've had a look at what makes us in terms of the asset base that we've got. We then looked at our road network, which is our static billboards and our digital billboards. We've got 45 million eyeballs that look at these on a monthly basis. Our radios, we've got over 3 million listeners a week across our four radio stations. We've got retail, we've got 9 million eyeballs on our retail inventory daily. We've got television, we've just entered into a partnership with Paramount. So we, because of the attention economy, we are no longer looking at competition like how we've looked at it before. So we've taken an approach of, because it's a mature space that we occupy, partner rather than compete, because disruption will either come from outside if we don't disrupt ourselves. So we are now partnering with what would have traditionally looked at as competitors, so that our value to the end user, to the consumer, as well as the people that consume, our value proposition must be fundamentally different. Digital, we have over 3 million unique subscribers of our content a month. And then we've also invested into the metaverse where we've bought land. So we're moving our existing and traditional mediums into the metaverse. So we've started to build studios into the metaverse, and we've started to build your avatars for our presenters. So Tando, for example, has an avatar, and therefore she'll also present from the metaverse. In terms of NFTs, we're investing in that world quite aggressively. Some people were at our industry event on the 29th of August, and our gift at the end of the night was actually an NFT. That just shows that we don't want to be left behind when it comes to this digital world and the metaverse, and therefore we're trading in that particular space as well. Why are we doing this? We're doing it so that we can establish more reach, widen our reach and frequency, engage better with the consumer, inform them in terms of our news offerings in all platforms, not just the traditional platforms that we're just known for. Entertainment, conversations, excitement, as well as inspiration, so that we keep up with the times quite aggressively and be able to touch people exactly in their preferred consumption platforms and methodologies, so that we adopt and inherently work within the digital space, because that's where people are and prefer to be. And therefore, our new competitive advantage is not in owning the platforms, but it's being platform agnostic, because our game plan is now more content, and therefore we must be where the person is, therefore tapping into that attention economy that I spoke about earlier. And I'll showcase a couple of how do, once we're there and we've got your attention, how do we make sure that we grab it and we offer value and impact as part of that particular conversation. But underpinning all of this in terms of our go-to-market is our value proposition. It must be enhanced. Now we're moving to speaking to everyone from SEM1 all the way to SEM10. So we've got audience diversity across our multiple channels and stations. We've got expanded channels and strategic alliances. I mentioned one of them being Paramount. We're partnering with the digital players, we're partnering with the television players and other radio players to expand this reach so that we can be absolutely everywhere where the consumer wants to be, so that we can give them that option and not force them to be on any specific platform. Client experience must be far superior, but using digital means to be able to automate absolutely everything that we've got. Marketing, as well as culture. In terms of how do we then unlock value for you? And I'll share a couple of things here. So we've taken a different approach. As I said, we've got the four radio stations that you do know, but we've now gone into adjacent areas that you wouldn't typically know us for. For example, we've bought full rights to The Masked Singer for South Africa, but we bring it differently to how anyone would actually thought that we'd bring it. We bring it in three different languages distinctly, in English, in isiZulu, as well as Afrikaans. And I'll share a glimpse of what that looks like now. And we will broadcast this on all major platforms. One is free to air, so on two SABC stations, one SABC 1 and SABC 3, as well as all other digital. So on TikTok, on YouTube, because we'll splice that content very differently. On Twitter, on Instagram, on Facebook, and all other streaming platforms that include Netflix, Prime, Paramount, as well as Pluto TV, as I said, in multiple languages. So in the attention economy, go find the consumer where they are instead of trying to drive them to where you want them to be. Just to show you a glimpse.
Coming soon, a top secret celebrity singing competition will have everyone asking who.
There's something incredibly special about you.
Is.
You got me thrown off.
The Masked Singer.
I'm so freaking confused right now. I don't know who I am.
The international music sensation comes to Fox. Underneath Mass, we have Grammy winners, Emmy winners, and Hall of Fame players. A weekly competition that will have audiences and our celebrity panel guessing.
You look very dashing for someone in a straitjacket.
So this will premiere in March next year, which is a high season, and it's going to be the biggest show in South Africa when it hits here. But you had heard it first. So in a single year, we'll have three seasons, as I said, in English, in isiZulu, as well as in Afrikaans, different to how it's ever been treated anywhere in the world. And the other way of communication, for those that are Joburg-based, you could have possibly seen this, what's called the Drip Campaign, which is the sneaker company. I personally love this story because it speaks to a young person, a young entrepreneur who's been able to now compete with the big brands in terms of how they've been able to just block out the highways when it comes to that outdoor campaign, and they've painted the town yellow, literally. The effect of that, his organization has grown so much because of the value of communicating and hitting the mark when he communicates, that there's other viral campaigns that are coming from that. But most importantly, his business has grown so much that he's starting other adjacent organizations, such as his kid apparel company and his other businesses that he's doing out of that. And he's had it for a few months now and continues to invest in that because of the effect and the power of that in terms of how you can just be creative around that. But I want to show you just also a glimpse of what it actually looks like for those that haven't seen it. So that campaign is unique in that it combines static as well as digital, but how we did that is we blocked out inventory in a way that you see it, and then the very next one and the very next one you see it, so that it's hyper-visible. And the combination of digital so that we can change it on a daily basis and make that much more impact. and he's the humblest guy, and the impact on his business has been incredible. We get almost weekly various big organizations asking us, can we buy that drip campaign? Can we do that and repeat that? And if you remember, this is a two-year-old organization that started on the boot of his car. It's now competing with the likes of the big guys. It's absolutely a great South African story. So it shows the power of great communication in smashing that attention threshold. We have, in terms of the context of where we are in the country, with inflation as high as it's going, so we need a content that's going to be uplifting people, but also a vehicle where we can give back to communities and society. And hence, we also bought the rights to Deal or No Deal, this very South African version, so customized, localized as well. This will be 260 episodes, so it'll play daily on SABC 1 with a repeat on SABC 3, so 6 o'clock and 8 o'clock repeat, as well as all other digital platforms so that we can give back as well. So this is also another incredible way to communicate. EWN TV, or EWN, or Eyewitness News, has over 18 million unique eyeballs a month, with over 4 million subscribers that are unique. And first to announce that we're actually converting this to EWN TV News. It'll also be on all digital platforms as well. And we'll do it in English and isiZulu, which is a 30-minute bulletin, which is another powerful way of communicating. It already has a community, but I just want to share an example of a news bulletin in terms of what it'll sound like.
Usalele Mgenge ngomunye wezinkulungwane zezisulu zezikhukhula zenyanga kaMbasa. Le mizi yesele isikhumbuzo sale nhlekelela eyenzeka. Nakuba umama kaSalele yena wakhetha ukuyokhosela ehholo lomphakathi oluseduzane leli kusayikhaya kuSalele nezinye izihlobo zakhe.
Lesi sine-trauma kakhulu because angikwazisho ukuhlala la endlini.
So just to show you a glimpse of what that looks like. But also tagging at the heartstrings. So in South Africa, we have not honored our heroes of the past appropriately. And I know my friend sitting up front will love this one in particular. So we've taken a task to go back in time and celebrate those heroes that were never appropriately celebrated. We'll do an hour documentary for each hero, someone like Miriam Makeba, someone like Brahuma Segela, and do a documentary. And then after that, we'll do a show with other singers honoring them in song as well in terms of putting on a concert, the proceeds of which will go to the family or the estate of that particular legend. And I want to share just a glimpse of what that looks like as well. So we're excited to be in partnership with Disney, bringing that to South Africa. The other innovations that we've done across our outdoor spaces is we're bringing Anamorphic into the country. But I see I've run out of time. I would have played you a video in terms of the jump out content as well that you can get out of this. Let's see if we can play this video for you. Can you try to play that video for me? Okay. I think there's a challenge, so let me move on. It's fine. You don't have to play it. So we've got 3D in all of the major malls. This is a four-ways mall site, but I'm not going to play the video. And also that jump out, the type of anamorphic that you see on Piccadilly Circus, on Times Square. So you'll see Sant and Radisson, for example, having all of those type of screens, or Mandela Square, having these type of really innovative jump out of the screen type of anamorphic presence that you'll get out of there. And any of these locations that you can see. We've also partnered recently with Label M, so we will be, and it's celebrating, Lion King is celebrating 25 years on Broadway. Therefore, we'll be in New York with him recording, because they've given him an hour special to now sing his songs, and we'll record that. But at the back of that, we'll then bring the Lion King back to where it belongs, to Africa. So Prime Media and Label M bringing the Lion King back into the country as well, and all of these type of content pieces that he's got. So I think as I said when I started, we are amongst the attention economy. The type of content, as I said, we have to be multi-platform and platform agnostic. The value of the content as well as how it lands, it needs to be able to grab their attention on multiple platforms, because that's where the consumer is. And if there's one thing I can leave you with, in your various organizations or entities or objectives that you try to drive, is not to look at competition like how you've always looked at it before, because essentially what you compete with is the attention of the person that you're looking to influence and convert. And that's the true competition, not the person that's also trying to sell to them. So you may be looking at the wrong place instead of looking for the person that you're trying to convert and get that particular decision. And that's where technology enables you to be able to do that. That's why artificial intelligence can empower you to do that. And therefore, do look forward to my next book, which, as I said, is called Decision Hacking, the Science of the Conversion, because how do you use everything around you to influence the outcome that you're looking for in every single instance? So it speaks to accuracy, it speaks to efficiency, so that you don't waste the communication, so that 8 seconds of the attention threshold, you can then smash it and make sure you get the results and the desired outcomes that you're looking for. And that's my time today, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Next is a panel discussion that will focus on unpacking the draft data and cloud policy.
Just checking whether I have to say good morning or good afternoon, but it's still good morning. So good morning, everybody, and thanks for joining our chat. We're looking at the draft data and cloud policy. I've got two panelists with me, Mike and Sia. Sia is in another session running a bit late, so he's going to join us as soon as he's finished with his session there. But in the meantime, Mike, can you maybe just introduce yourself to us?
Sure. So I'm Mike Silber. I'm a Group Chief Regulatory Officer at Liquid Intelligent Technologies and General Counsel at Africa Data Centers, and was chairing the Data and Cloud Working Group within the DCA that pulled together the DCA response to the draft Data and Cloud Policy.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll have Sia introduce himself when he arrives. So it's been roughly about 17 months since we've had our draft data and cloud policy published. And we were chatting outside, I was saying, so when I initially read this policy, I got the same feeling when I read the green paper of the Electronic Communications and Transactions Act. Because you get a feeling that government realizes that they're on the verge of a whole new development, and we need to figure out how we deal with it. So it's still a draft, 17 months around, give or take, around. And so I think we can use the opportunity this morning to reflect on what sort of happened in the past 17 months and see how we take that into a final policy going forward. So there's basically four major data, not data, building blocks into getting a successful cloud sort of policy together, right? It's data centers, the brick and mortar part of it. It's the data storage and computing platforms. Broadband is very important. And then also the security aspect. But I think for now, Mike, while we've got you here, if we can maybe look at the brick and mortar part of the data center aspect of it. So first, hot potato, we know that there's been a foreign investment into Teraco. Good or bad, do you have any comments on that transaction and what that means for data centers in the concept of South Africa and the policy?
Well, what I think makes it clear is that there are a number of entities, but it's not just the investment into Teraco, but it's also, if you look at Vantage entering, if you look at our split of the Liquid data centers into ADC, there are a lot of businesses that are seeing Africa as a nascent data center market, our friends at WIAC and their OADC initiative, I should mention. But there's a recognition of significant potential within the Africa data center market. And as much as the South African data center market is significantly more mature than various other parts of the African market, there is still opportunity for growth here. How much growth is, in my mind, going to be somewhat constrained by what policies we put in place.
Okay, thanks. So, as we from a data center perspective, just before we go there, Sia, nice to have you with us. Glad you could make it. And if you would mind just to introduce yourself to the audience.
Hi, my name is Sia Makibi. I'm the director for corporate legal and external affairs at Microsoft.
Thank you very much. So we're just on data centers right now as a key pillar of a data and cloud strategy in South Africa. And we'll talk about broadband just now, but what we're seeing as a technology in broadband is 5G. But 5G is a much smaller a network coverage area. So is that impacting on data centers, Mike?
Well, I think it goes to the question in terms of what do we need? And this is where the policy is useful, but maybe is a little confused and it's not necessarily fully appreciating the extent of the data center market. You obviously have the large hyperscale facilities. They tend to be clustered around major metro areas, firstly because of utilization, secondly because of connectivity hubs, and thirdly because that's where the skills are. But as we're seeing more data consumption across the country, including in more far-flung areas, there's going to be an increase in the number of edge data centers that are required. And 5G is going to potentially, at least this is the theory, and we're starting to see this happening in some jurisdictions where there's greater 5G coverage. For the last few decades, we've seen consolidation of network assets into more centralized networking. You know, pulling together 4G network has allowed mobile operators to restructure their network deployments. You know, the days of switching centers spread out across the country from the old fixed line networks has long passed, and you can have a small number of switching centers around the country. 5G is likely to counteract that, and we're going to need to push data centers and data connectivity back to the regions, back to more far-flung areas. The question is, can those existing switching centers be used? And my view is generally no, because those were purpose-built for a fixed-line telco or for a 2G mobile network. The likelihood is that you want to see economies of scale, you want to see co-location facilities, and you're going to see significant growth in edge data centers happening across the globe. So I think there's this tension between additional hyperscale data center builds within major metros, and then significant growth of edge facilities as well as cable landing stations happening on the coast or in more far-flung areas.
So thank you for that, Mike. So Sia, looking at data storage and computing platforms, as we see the proliferation of data and privacy laws across the globe, data residency becomes super topical. And you know, the challenge is to keep your data inside in territory. We know the top three data platforms or top three cloud providers are Microsoft, Dropbox, and Google Drive. But what are you seeing happening from a South African perspective in terms of data residency?
So in South Africa, we about think 2-3 years back, we had the minister issue what was at the time called a data and cloud policy, which spoke in the main to data residency being a requirement for South Africa. What that means essentially is that for government data specifically, and I know this applies in the FSI industry as well, for banks, that you have to keep your data inside the country. Mm. What that does, I think it's a sword that cut both ways, in the sense that it attracts investment, it forces the big players to come to South Africa to locate data centers in South Africa. Microsoft, as an example, became the first multinational to do so. With data centers in Johannesburg, with data centers in Cape Town, when you're able to replicate data and in both areas. So whether it's at rest, whether it's in transit, that data stays in South Africa. And I think we've seen a lot of a proliferation after that of other companies coming into South Africa. I think South Africa has now become almost like a launch pad for the rest of the continent from a data center perspective. So you've seen the likes of AWS have launching data centers in South Africa. We've seen Oracle, we've seen Google doing that. And that is in the main because there's a regulatory requirement that you have to locate your data must reside in South Africa. So it attracts investment from that perspective. Obviously, it's got technical advantages as well. Your latency issues are all addressed with your data being locally based. But the other side of the sword is also that it does, in a way, mean that we lose out on other cloud service providers that do not physically have the capability to come and locate in South Africa, right? So it does mean that ultimately you have a limited number of players that have the capital to be able to come down here. And as long as you have data residency requirements, what that means is that some potential players that could come and add to jobs and add to competition are not able to do so because you have specific localization of data requirements. So those players that would be operating whether in Europe, whether in Nigeria, whether in the US, because you've got that is a requirement, they're not able to come to South Africa. So you potentially, you're closing, there's a part of the global market that you're closing yourself out from, which does become a disadvantage. You would know that in the modern hyperscale, the way the data centers operate, really the physical location of the data center itself no longer makes any difference. So whether your data is in Europe, whether your data is in the US, you will have, of course, slight latency issues, but the reality of it is that they're designed in such a way that it doesn't matter where your data is located. I mean, if you take a cell phone, for instance, in a lot of instances, whether it's Apple, whether it's Samsung, that data does not reside in South Africa. It's located in data centers outside South Africa. But when you download and upload stuff, the latency effect there, I mean, it's there, but it's minimal. And I know in a business or commercial enterprises, that's critical, but technology has advanced to a point where it makes it negligible these days. So it's good in a way that it attracts investment, and we've seen a lot of data centers coming to South Africa, but it also has a negative effect in the sense that it closes us out from potential, especially entrepreneurial type cloud providers that are able to provide services across the globe, but it becomes difficult to do so in South Africa because you have specific localization requirements in South Africa.
So can I pick up on that? Because I think we may have missed a trick with the policy in its current formulation. And that is not taking advantage of opportunities offered in terms of the Pan-African approach, the African Free Trade Zone, looking at a African Union data privacy and data migration policies. Because the reality is that you're unlikely to find more than one country in some of the regions that is actually able to scale to hyperscale. Kenya in East Africa, Nigeria in West Africa, South Africa in South Africa, the North Africa is a slightly different market because of access to some of the Mediterranean submarine cables. But have we potentially missed a trick to actually say, create a regional data policy, because I'm not sure if you personally have been looking at it, but I'm guessing Microsoft has looked at Botswana and Zambia and Zimbabwe and Namibia, and you've gone, we'd love to be there and we'd love to offer more services there, but there just isn't the necessary scale for us to build a full-scale, hyperscale deployment in those territories. At best, we're going to put down an edge facility over there. That then has an impact in terms of the ability to data localize if you're just doing edge, because most of your compute power is going to be sitting in your hyperscale facilities in South Africa.
Correct. Correct. And we're seeing a lot of that in the continent. Part of the challenge that comes with that is, unlike in Europe, for instance, where you've got GDPR, and then you have the ease of being able to invest in one part of Europe, and then you know that the regulatory requirement from a data privacy security perspective is the same across a multiplicity of countries. In Africa, that's significantly different, in the sense that in each and every country where you invest, potentially you're dealing with different sets of data regulations, you're dealing with a different set of security, and so you have to be mindful of that. So over and above the fact that you have to have the capital layout that you have to keep in mind in terms of the investment that you make, but just the general regulatory environment that you're dealing with, it changes and it differs from country to country, which makes it very difficult to have that consistency, which attracts generally external investors, of knowing that you're dealing with the same regulatory environment across the board. So that becomes quite a factor as well.
It's a bit of a fine balancing act, though, because you've got network technologies driving edge data centers, and you've got data laws requiring data residency within borders, but it sort of is counterproductive to cloud, which is much more of a centralized one location sort of model. So, you know, I think that's something that is quite a difficult task to balance within the policy. Just to make sure we stay within time, just want to touch on broadband quickly, because we can have data centers, we can have software, we can have hardware, we can have all of the elements. If we don't have connectivity to it, it's useless. So broadband is really critical, and we know that the majority of South Africans access their internet via their mobile devices. So there's mobile networks that we need to focus on, and then also there's quite an aggressive rollout of fiber in South Africa. From a mobile perspective, Mike, spectrum auction done, dusted. Is there a silver lining, or is it business as usual? What's your general feel there?
So, we're not seeing the new spectrum that's been obtained being fully deployed just yet, but I am expecting that we'll start seeing significant deployments coming through. It has two impacts. The positive impact is we're going to be able to push far greater throughput across those networks. So that's fantastic for all of us. It deals with some of the latency issues that CEO was talking about. It potentially drives the need for more edge data centers as there's more data flowing through those networks, whether those fixed or mobile, wireless, fiber, whatever it may be. We're likely to see a lot more data, and you know, as a data center provider, that's great because we'll see more data centers. The negative is, with networks spending so much capex on the network deployment, it means that we in the data center space need to keep up the same level of investment in the data center space, which should be good for co-location. It also means that there's more drain on power, and I can't talk about data centers, seeing as our biggest consumable within the data center space is power. Unless we have a stable power environment in this country with with some degree of consistency in policy around power generation and access to renewables and wheeling across various grids, we're going to continue to have a problem. You know, Eskom has got a well-advanced wheeling program, and if you happen to be in an Eskom territory, it's much easier as a data center operator. But as soon as you happen to be sitting within one of the metros, and you're having to deal with the vagaries of local government and local government cross-subsidization of industrial and residential, as well as inefficiencies, that creates a huge issue for the data center space. And that's going to be, in my view, one of the biggest restrictions on actually growing the data center market. As much as we're going to need more edge facilities, we certainly wouldn't put an edge facility somewhere where we don't have reliable power.
And I think we're going to wrap up with recommendations on the final policy, but just as a last question on the broadband, we've touched on the mobile side. On the fiber side, we know your higher LSM areas are pretty much built out in the country. And there's a big drive now to move into your lower LSM areas with your hybrid sort of like terrestrial fiber installations with a wireless last mile or last millimeter, if you want to call it that way. Are we seeing enough happening from a policy perspective to support those rollouts? Because that's where the majority of data users are located in South Africa. I know of some initiatives where there's foreign aid coming in, but I'd just like to hear, and maybe CIA, if you know about any shortcomings or positive points that you can share, I'd love to hear from you.
I think the biggest policy challenge that we face at the moment is speaking to what Mike just spoke to right now around spectrum for mobile operators, is I think there's a big gap that we have in the market now in the sense that we don't have a regulatory environment that encourages alternative technologies. Our regulatory environment in the main is focusing on the technologies that are supported or driven by main operators, whether that be from a satellite perspective, whether that be from a mobile broadband perspective, or whether that be from a fixed line fiber perspective. So a lot of regulations that are coming out. I mean, I know that Digital Council of Africa, for instance, has been doing a lot from a fiber space, working with municipalities, trying to open up that space. That's where the biggest concentration of our regulatory environment is right now. But if you think about alternative technologies, going back to the point that we were making earlier, that one of the best ways to democratize access to technology is to ensure that our far-flung areas, we create alternatives to make sure that there's connectivity that goes into those areas. From a Microsoft perspective, for instance, one of the things we've been championing, one of the things we have done, is we've piloted TV white spaces as an alternative technology. Mm-hmm. We know that TV white spaces, for instance, as opposed to a normal 3G or 4G base station that covers about 5-8 kilometers, same base station using TV white spaces will cover about 20 to 30 kilometers. So that technology works in rural areas, and it's less capital intensive because of the network layout that you need to have. But the regulatory environment in South Africa is just not there. We know, for instance, that in other countries, it uses what is called unregulated spectrum, or the guard bands between broadcasting and telecoms. And we've seen attempts by the regulator in South Africa, for instance, to move into that space. Regulations, I think, just before COVID, were issued that related to TV white spaces. But then there was a database that had to be created for operators to register and so that from a interference perspective, they're able to be controlled using that database. That's a process that's taken more than 3 or 4 years to come into fruition. As a result, everybody who's in South Africa right now who's talking TV white spaces is doing so more on a pilot perspective rather than ability to be able to commercialize that. So there's for me, there's a big opportunity that's still out there for the regulator to look at alternative technologies. One of the big misses, for instance, from the spectrum that was recently allocated, for me at least, was the fact that it became very commercial. We've seen in other geographies where when spectrum is being allocated, part of the incentives that operators are being given, which lowers the capital intensity that they have to go through, is they get given incentives to go into rural areas using that spectrum, and then they get credits for that and ultimately pay less for buying the spectrum itself. We didn't see that happening here. The regulator just went flat out on a commercial basis. It was higher speed up, commercially, and it ended there. There were no additional obligations that operators could have been given, which would have been an incentive for them to go into those areas. So combine that with the fact that we do not have alternatives in a regulated environment that encourages alternative technologies, it means that there's still a long way ahead for us to be able to truly service the far-flung areas.
Oh, awesome, thank you. So we've run out of time, so I'm going to ask Mike and Sia, each of you, just a quick comment, overall sort of sentiment on the draft policy, and maybe one or two recommendations on what we can put into a final policy in terms of going forward. I'll start with you, Mike.
My first thought is that having a policy position is always useful. And I think that there's some things that the policy should set out. What is South Africa's view on issues like data localization? What potential incentives there are to make us a friendlier destination for cloud and data center providers, to increase adoption, to turn us into a data hub for the Southern African region? I think those are all good. I think there are a number of very flawed suggestions in the policy which don't hang together with the incentive of a forward-looking policy. But on the whole, I think having policy is good. Sia touched on it. We have been working in fits and starts. We don't seem to have a big picture view of where we're trying to get to from an ICT space. And so we're chasing initiatives. Fantastic that we finally got the spectrum auction done, but we didn't seem to have a fully thought through plan in terms of why we're doing it, what are we trying to get out of it, how can we get the best value for operators, consumers, and society as a whole. And I think if we can relook at the policy through that lens, I think that'll be incredibly useful to allow us to actually reconsider some of the items. This notion that, just as an example, I don't want to get into the detail, but the idea that government data should be open access data is fantastic. It means people can gain access to cadastral information, population information, great. But then there was some clumsy wording which led a lot of people to conclude, including myself, that there was a potential of data nationalization, for lack of a better term. And so I think that, setting some aspirational targets are good. It's very useful. It'll be great to have the policy in place, but let's not try and get into the weeds, because there were some things that were really likely to stick in the craw of industry and users.
And so I think quickly from my side, I think we're seeing pockets of policy progression. From a cloud and data perspective. The Department of Public Service Administration recently issued directives on cloud and on security, which are good. They're fairly balanced directives, right? They're not. Ultimately, we need to find an alignment to international benchmarks. But what it does, at least, it begins to create a path for government CIOs, at least, to have a very clear view in terms of if they want to move from on-premise into the cloud, what does that journey look like? How do you embark on that journey in a way that becomes compliant with government standards, with minimum security requirements that SSA requires? So I think we're well on that path. But the reality of it is that those are just pockets of progression. Ultimately, we do need a national framework from a cloud policy. What we saw as the first attempt, it was a good attempt, but I think, as Mike just said, there were some very concerning aspects that came out of that regulation. We hope that the new minister will have a relook at that, and ultimately, because a lot industry made quite some serious comments in terms of what needs to change there. We're hoping that the new minister is looking at those changes, and hopefully, sometime soon, we'll have something that will align to international benchmarks. Because ultimately, If you are an investor sitting in the US, sitting in Europe, chances are that you're not going to know about the DPSA directives. But if there's a national framework that talks to cloud, that talks to data, that gives a little bit more certainty in terms of how South Africa thinking about issues of data residency, localization, and then from an investor perspective, that gives a little more certainty in terms of if you put your money, how does that the ROI work for you in that regard. So I think we're getting there, we're doing it in pockets, but I think ultimately there's a need for a national framework.
Thank you very much, and gentlemen, thank you very much for your time this morning, and hopefully we can wrap up a final policy and get certainty and move forward going forward rather soon. Thank you very much.
An address by cloud infrastructure services providers in Europe. Director of Communications, Cloud Infrastructure Service Providers in Europe, CISP.cloud. As a communications director of CISP.cloud, he helps formulate and articulate the views of members and present them to policymakers, industry, and media influencers. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ben Maynard.
Well, thank you very much. I've just seen my picture there. I need to update that, I think. Exceptionally young. Thank you for inviting me and welcoming here to speak to you today. I'm very excited to share some insights and some views from Europe, which I hope will be a relevance and interest to you. I've got to say, it's been a fantastic conference. I've really enjoyed listening to the many speeches, and I've been really struck by the honesty, the determination, and the real focus on building a digital environment that leaves no one behind. So I think that's hugely to be applauded. So to quickly introduce myself, I'm a communications consultant. I've spent the last 25 years helping technology companies to transform complex messages, complex arguments into compelling narratives. Working at the confluence of technology, policy, and media, it's my job to try and influence non-tech decision makers to make the right decision. I've worked with CISPE for the last couple of years, and I'd like to start today by introducing the organization, talking about some of our initiatives, and then talking about some of the wider context in Europe and how that might have some mirroring and some prefiguring of perhaps what could happen here in Africa. And then to sort of distill from that maybe some learnings that may be of use as things go forward. So I'm conscious that I'm standing between you and lunch, or one other session and lunch, so hopefully we can move on relatively quickly and hopefully have some time for questions at the end. So CISPE, the Cloud Infrastructure Service Providers in Europe. We were born in 2016. Our initial focus was actually to debate and devise a practical approach to helping cloud infrastructure service providers encourage safe and secure use of processing of data, personal data, in Europe. This was actually before the introduction of the GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation, and it's an early example of our proactivity in helping the industry find practical solutions to respond to incoming legislative, regulatory, and reputational demands. By connecting the industry in a debate, we're able to view what was needed through a multitude of lenses and find agreed paths forward. I was struck yesterday listening to so many sessions that the threads of collaboration, balance, fair participation, dialogue are common themes which are coming out. And I think I would argue that one of the great values that CISPE provides is creating the spaces where that balance can be achieved. In the same vein, this actually led CISPE to be a found member of GAIA-X, which is Europe's kind of ambition to bring players from across the industry together to create a common set of rules and procedures so that everybody can work together to support a transparent and interoperable cloud and data services environment. So we're very much at the heart of that and very keen to drive those sort of initiatives forward. Similarly, we're also co-founders of the Climate Neutral Data Center Pact, and I'll talk about more of that in the next few minutes. So as you can see on the slide, we've got 26 members. They range from small local focused providers to hyperscalers. We operate across Europe, 14 different countries represented across our membership. In the summer of last year, we actually began to look beyond Europe see where else we can sort of try to provide this kind of convening service. So we signed memorandums of understanding with two organizations last year, an organization called CISB with an I in Israel, and with the Digital Council of Africa, hence your kind invitation to come and speak to you today. So what do we do for those members, and why do we do it? We represent the interests of our members, ensuring that they have a voice and that their views and their concerns are heard by all three parts of the EU legislative body, so the Parliament, the Commission, and the Council. We provide technical understanding, practical examples, and guidance to help achieve good and effective regulation and legislation. I was interested in one of the final comments of the last panel was that quite often you see a policy which is 95% there, and then some clumsy language kind of upsets it. And we see that very much as our role to make sure that clumsy language is eradicated as soon as possible, and we actually get very clear regulation that works for everyone. So we create this kind of unique space where we can bring the diverse views of a wide range of members to bear on these things, and importantly make sure that the specific interests of cloud infrastructure are understood. So our players are the people who provide the bottom end of that pyramid. We don't do the SaaS stuff over the top. It is just the infrastructure, and making sure that nuance is understood is crucial to the work that we can do. I think, however, the greatest value that we provide is that we're not just an advocacy body. We actually create practical tools that allow our members and the wider members of the ecosystem to not only identify what needs to be done, but to actually move some way to how to achieve it. So getting those tools together to allow people to do the how is really central to what CISBE does. And so I'd like to show you four examples of how we've done that recently, which hopefully will have some resonance for you as well. So the first of these, as I mentioned, the CISBE Code of Conduct for Data Protection was our first initiative, although it took a while from 2016 when we initially convened people to talk about it to actually getting it ratified. Some of that was due down to the bureaucracy in Europe rather than our own alacrity. But it was a key initiative that we wanted to do. We started, as I say, before GDPR was drafted. We anticipated the need to be able to demonstrate security and fair treatment of personal data as being fundamental to trust in the cloud. As I intimated before, as infrastructure players, we neither access nor control personal data, the personal data that our customers manage on behalf of their customers. But nevertheless, it is crucial that infrastructure can be shown to include all the requisite data protection elements needed by any services that are then running over it. For those to be compliant. So the Code of Conduct is a great example of that how in action. GDPR itself defines what is needed. The Code of Conduct is all about providing a framework that any cloud infrastructure provider can use to achieve the how of compliance. So people can download the code, they can assess themselves against it initially, or they can be assessed by a third party, and then they can publicize that their services are GDPR compliant with the code. We did this in very close cooperation with the French Data Protection Authority, the CNIL, and the CISBE code was, and I think still is, the only cloud infrastructure specific code to be approved by the European Data Protection Board, which is the overall body that ratifies these things. Interestingly, the code also, and to remark on the earlier conversation about data residency, data sovereignty, the CISBE code is the only code that stipulates services must have the option to locate data within, in our case, the European Economic Area. We think that's the way forward, that you have to have the choice to do it. Not all data needs to be resident, but some data wants to be resident, so you have to have that option built in, and our code gives services the ability to certify that they have that requirement, so that any services running over them will be able to comply to any data sovereignty needs that there may be. The second initiative was, again, I think hopefully particularly of interest to here in South Africa as the Draft Data and Cloud Act come to fruition. It is all about helping specifically public authorities procure cloud services and therefore promote the cloud as a framework and a platform for the public sector. The nature of the cloud, its as-a-service DNA, means procurement is very different from procuring many of the other things that that governments are used to purchasing. So helping organizations to build the skills and experience needed to effectively contract cloud services is, again, another practical value that we believe Syspay has brought to the market. Our first handbook was published in 2019 and has already been used not only across the EU, but actually more broadly in Japan and in other places in Southeast Asia as well, as a framework for procurement. The 2022 edition, which was published in the springtime, as with all the others, it's freely downloadable. It's not a service, so people can go and download it and use it. And it's available in 12 languages on the website. If you go there, you'll find that it's got advice and templates, very practical things that can be easily deployed and implemented. Things like, you know, how to actually set up an RFP process for the cloud. How do you establish the minimum technical requirements that you're looking for? How do you run technical evaluation? So real nuts and bolts stuff that can help any department looking to move to the cloud. So please do have a look at it and see if it can be useful to you. The third initiative here, talks to another significant issue rising on the horizon, both from authorities and indeed from the general public, in terms of the increasing scrutiny that data centers are under from a climatic and environmental position. So, in close collaboration with the Commission, who were very much looking to the industry to say, how can you show us how you will help us get to our targets for climate neutrality. So they came to us to actually help provide that. So working closely with the EUDCA, which is the European Union Data Center Association, Syspay co-founded the Climate Neutral Data Center Pact. So this is a voluntary self-regulatory initiative which is a way for the entire industry to move quickly towards climate neutrality. Although it was in response to the Commission's desire to get there by 2050, we're actually going faster and further, and our signatories are committed to climate neutrality by 2030. So we think this is a unique example of an entire industry actually coming together, putting aside its competitive issues to work on a single critical goal. We have over 100 signatories, which collaboratively between them represent over 90% of the installed data center capacity in Europe. So pretty much everybody who's anybody is a member of the pact. And that includes, you know, the hyperscalers, it includes co-location providers, it includes small single data center providers, as well as many of the associations that represent them. It's a great example of the industry really listening and working with authorities to understand the concerns and understand how to try and make regulation legislation work in practice. It's not a lobbying organization, it's a very practical organization that is focused on defining the metrics and the measures that will work, that can be deployed. And again, this is an important part of our role is we understand the policy goal and we understand the need to do things. We need to work with industry to make sure those things can be done in a way that is effective and deliverable. So we're sitting down, we've got working groups working on key areas, energy efficiency, use of carbon-free energy, water consumption, reuse and recycling of equipment, and reuse, recycling of the heat produced by data centers. So these working groups are looking at that technical understanding of what can be measured, what should be measured, how can we measure it, and let's put a hard goal in that that then all members will commit to achieving. Our most recent initiative is also significant as authorities everywhere seek to use and promote the cloud as a foundation for a wider digital transformation. Both our members and organizations representing IT business users have expressed concerns that legacy licensing practices are restricting their choice and flexibility as they move to the cloud. Terms and conditions that were originally generated in the CD-ROM age are making expensive, technically challenging, and contractually unclear to companies as they seek to shift their enterprise and productivity software from on-premises into the cloud. Some of these licensing terms are unfair and can lock customers into cloud infrastructures provided by dominant legacy providers that prevent them from deploying on infrastructure that makes most sense to them. Faced with these concerns, we work closely with an organization called SIGREF, which is the French Association of Digital Leaders, represents some of the largest, CIOs from some of the largest businesses in France. So we work with them to create what we christened the 10 principles of fair software licensing. These are designed to help any customer as they move to the cloud to assess the terms and conditions that they're presented with to make sure that they can move unencumbered to the cloud and really benefit from the flexibility, interoperability, scalability that cloud can provide. Any software licenses that adhere to these principles will allow customers to pick the best clouds, run multi-clouds, and develop on infrastructure that makes most sense to their specific requirements. We know this is a significant issue. We undertook a study last year with world-renowned economics and competition expert Professor Jenny. And his work highlighted the ways in which unfair licensing can restrict choice, damage innovation, increase costs, and undermine the value of shifting to the cloud. Over 2,500 CIOs representing 700 organizations across Europe have ratified that research and the licensing principles. And increasingly, we're finding this is not a European, but it is a global issue. We've already worked with our sister organization, CISPE with an I in Israel, to launch the principles there earlier this year. And this week we saw research from the US, which was covered in Bloomberg, I think on Tuesday this week, saying that 70% of CIOs in the US felt that unfair software licensing costs were also restricting their ability to release products and features as they wished, and 90% of those also support these principles. So we feel this is a global issue. It's beginning to gain traction, and I think that any organization looking to move to the cloud, you know, should run their licensing through the principles to ensure that they are able to move unencumbered to the cloud and not have any restriction on the choices that they make. So that's what we've been doing. I thought I might take a few minutes now to talk a little bit about the kind of wider context against which all this is happening. Really, in the last decade, in the last 5 years certainly, we've seen the cloud move from being an esoteric techie issue on the fringes to becoming actually a core foundational technology with implications for policy and regulation across almost every area of the EU's agenda. From the delivery of government services to gaming, from media and information to transportation and industry, from strategic autonomy of technology to sustainable solutions, the cloud has a critical role to play. Europe's digital decade and the steps to achieving it by 2030, the Digital Compass, which was recently ratified earlier this month by the Parliament, seeks to define a set of rights and principles for Europeans that, well, to quote, empower business and people in a human-centered, sustainable, and more prosperous digital future. Like Africa, Europe is actually a diverse continent with widely differing levels of digital penetration and digital skills. We also have a firm set of goals for digital transformation. We want to achieve vibrant, modern society, which is inclusive and which no one gets left behind. We're seeking to build high-skill, high-wage jobs that can create sustainable employment and satisfaction to people from all walks of life. and we're committed to achieving this in an environmentally sustainable way. Broad understanding of the critical path that cloud plays in all of this is essential to achieve these goals. Overall, the use of cloud has doubled between 2014 and 2021. In 2014, just 18% of European companies were using the cloud. Today, it's 41%. And it's expected to have accelerated further thanks to the COVID-19 epidemic. Currently, the cloud is worth about 53.9 billion euros in 2020. It's expected to grow to 135.9 billion euros by 2025, so in 3 short years' time. But there is significant variation in between European states and between larger companies and smaller companies in their use of the cloud. So what this means for our members, our industry, is that we find ourselves at the heart of some of the biggest and most important policy decisions of the decade. And that's a good thing. Europe's desire to be at the forefront of addressing digital issues and establishing clear approaches to dealing with them is to be applauded. And it means that our members have a critical role to play in setting policy that will not only impact Europe, but could become a model to be used around the world. That added scrutiny is important. Building an infrastructure for the cloud, we're highly conscious that the decisions we make will underpin not only technical capabilities, but freedom of choice, competitiveness, innovation, all of which are essential to creating those vibrant ecosystems that we all want. So we see our role as essential to promoting good policy and fair regulation of our industry. Significant pieces of legislation in the last year and ongoing have required intensive focus from us in terms of engaging and making sure that they deliver on their objectives and don't end up with unintended consequences. For example, CISPO has been closely involved in providing industry insight onto the twin packages of the Digital Services Act and the Digital Markets Act, which have been agreed at a political level by Commission, Parliament, and Council. They jointly seek to create a safer and more open digital space that benefits citizens, as well as participating and providing services. At CISPE, we saw this vital contribution to industry, but understood that obviously it needed to be done correctly in order to make sure our members' interests were fully protected and the industry as a whole was given the scope and the canvas to continue to grow. So by bringing together that insight, we were able to work closely and influence the language in many ways on both those acts to make sure that we got regulations, which, yes, they're still going to be difficult to implement, and they are by no means perfect, but hopefully we've moved them in the right direction. We're beginning to do the same with the Data Act, which is kind of the next big piece of legislation on the shelf. In Europe, that's looking at trying to do for non-personal data, what GDPR did for personal data, to create a free flow of data that can be used and reused to create real advantages for industry and for governments and for all players. Again, making sure that language is right, that the ideas of interoperability, shareability, sovereignty are all articulated in the right way is crucial. Slightly more offbeat, we're also involved with the Energy Efficiency Directive, and so we're seeing a great deal of scrutiny on the power taken to manage IT and data centers in particular. So again, we have to work very hard to make sure that whilst the Energy Efficiency Directive is clearly needed and clearly important, we need to make sure that it is referenced in exactly the right way so that all the good that the digital infrastructure can provide is not lost by some unforeseen regulations around that. So thinking about what we've learned from that is it's clear that cloud and cloud infrastructure are fundamental to digital transformation, and they rapidly move up the political agenda. As I said, you know, even a few years ago, cloud was not a topic of conversation amongst the corridors of Brussels. Today it is in every corridor and every day. And we need to make sure that we work hard to make sure that conversation is held in the right way and is well informed. It's the challenge we face, I guess, is because what we do is quite esoteric, it's quite technical, it's quite complex, and policymakers don't often have the depth of understanding, the depth of knowledge to really understand the nuance of some of those issues. That's probably the thing that we've learned most, is we have to engage early, we have to engage in depth, and we have to bring to the table a wide range of views to quickly educate and bring people up to speed. I would add to that, I think the other learning is the nuance of language is critical. So as I said, you know, explaining our role as infrastructure service providers as opposed to platform or service providers is critical, and understanding what those differences mean in a policy context demands very precise language and very accurate and continued briefing. It's a question of telling people and then telling them again and then telling them again and then going off and telling the next person and the next person and the next person. So it's a forever job, but it's something that we really believe we heartily need to engage with. So I think, you know, I suppose my third outcome is that, you know, we have recognized that to get the outcomes we want, we as an industry need to put skin in the game. And that means not just advocating, but actually providing the tools that help with the how. So if we can be a partner to policymakers and show them how things can be done easily with, you know, with little lift from there, I think that allows us to get to the right answers. And it puts us in the heart of where we are, as where we want to be, as architects of the future that we want to see. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention. I don't know if there's any questions. I think we've got a couple, well, maybe just a minute for a question, if anybody has any. But thank you for your attention. Okay. Thank you. Yes.
Ben, hi. Karabo Mojana, AWS.
Good to see you.
A lot of the work that CISP is doing is being spoken to in a continental context, in the European common market, as it were.
Yep.
And a lot of the what has been taken from Europe in terms of ICT regulation has been broken down into country-specific regulations in many parts of the world. Is there any mechanisms that can be used to reconstruct the market in a more holistic, more regional terms to enable all the benefits of CISP type or European type regulation to flow through on a continental or regional basis?
That's a very good question. And it's still an ongoing fight even in Europe as to the delegation of those authorities and what happens at a national level and what happens at a regional level. I think the GDPR was probably one of the first examples of a directive that was enforced. So countries didn't, on that occasion, have the option to interpret that in the way that they wanted. It had to be applied as it was. And the reason for that was, you know, one of the reasons for the GDPR was that we had, you know, 27 different privacy directives that were incomprehensible to each other. And so when it works, it does work. There are still arguments about, you know, what gets derogated. I mean, even with the DMA, the latest rules, France and Germany are also already looking at, you know, perhaps how we want to reinterpret that to imply in our body. So I think, as many people have said in various sessions today, all these things are great if they can work at a regional level and give people that structure and that certainty that things are going to be the same country by country. In reality, it's not often quite as easy as that. I don't know whether that answers your question or not. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Joining us is the Group Executive of IT and Partners at Africa Data Centers, presenting on data centers and cloud topic. He was born and educated in Johannesburg, South Africa, and has a BSc in Electrical Engineering in 1987 and a PhD in Digital Transmission 1998 from the University of Witwatersrand. He is a fellow of the SAIEE, was chairman of its Electronic and Software Committee in 2005, and received the Institute's Annual Young Achiever Award in 1999. Please welcome Dr. Angus Hay.
Good afternoon, all. I'm conscious of the fact that I'm standing between you and lunch, so I'm hoping that I can keep you entertained at least for half an hour. I'm going to talk a little bit about the infrastructure for Africa's cloud. We've heard a lot about what infrastructure providers are, but I want to talk about what we're doing in Africa, in particular as Africa data centers. The picture in the center, I thought, kind of epitomized everything that we need to know about infrastructure for cloud. At the foot of the mountain, the lights are on. That's a really good thing in South Africa nowadays. The cloud is coming over the mountain, and as you know, the cloud was more or less invented in Cape Town. So I think based on that, let me dive in and talk to you a little bit about who we are first. So this is the obligatory advertising slide telling you who we are. We are Africa's first network of interconnected carrier and cloud-neutral data centers. We're part of the Cassava Technologies Group. You've not heard of that, Google it. And we are a pure infrastructure provider. We're not in the business of IT. We don't do managed services. We don't do telecoms. We don't do all that stuff. We are a co-location provider. We're a co-location provider from one rack up to hyperscale. And at the hyperscale end of the market, we are increasingly a specialist that can build to suit for the hyperscalers that are coming onto the African continent. The rest of the services there are what you will see that, typically go with the provision of an infrastructure service. So we offer our power on a, pay-per-use basis. We offer cross-connects, and we are building out a fabric, which in due course will be announced to the market, which will give a more more sophisticated ecosystem for connectivity. We host internet exchanges in every single one of our facilities, and we also offer connections onto the cloud. We are an open access, carrier-neutral, cloud-neutral provider of infrastructure. And customers buy from us because they get reliability, they get 100% availability, they get security at world-class, and they get access to connectivity, because obviously our data centers form the hubs of the cloud and the internet. So, is Africa ready for the cloud? According to Zalem Analytics in a fairly recent report, maybe. So a number of countries, and just to be clear what I'm talking about here, this is the cloud itself. So in other words, the enterprise-based cloud services offered to businesses looking at the, enterprise market in each country. I'll come to the next slide, you'll see what I mean. But for the enterprise market, actual cloud services being used by enterprises in country, there are a few countries that, on the beginning of that list, that really are ready and in fact are beyond ready and are significant users of cloud services from a multitude of providers. If you are familiar with the current rankings in cloud, you'll notice that the list down the right-hand side is sort of in order of size. I don't have the numbers for Africa, but it's kind of the same order. But there are a whole lot of countries that are becoming ready for cloud. And the opportunity that we see for building infrastructure for the cloud in Africa is precisely that. We've seen a massive uptick in the requirement for infrastructure for cloud starting in South Africa and starting to move across the continent on the left-hand side of that picture. As we move through the rest of that picture, and we expect this to be over the next decade, perhaps two decades, we will see that move of the cloud to the edge and increasing deployment of infrastructure across the continent. I said I'd surprise you with the next slide. I said that there are countries that are ready for the cloud. That's only true in the enterprise space, that there are countries that are not ready for the cloud. In the consumer space, in the broader market, the eyeballs, the people looking at the content, everybody's using the cloud. We have particularly high mobile penetration across most countries of Africa, and if you don't have those on your mobile phone, I would be very surprised. So that list is kind of split up into three areas. On the right-hand side, you can see, let's call it the sort of conventional set of applications, social media kind of things that you need to have access to that are workhorses for everybody, both in business and as consumers nowadays. The left-hand side is more interesting because that we have seen a very massive swing to the provision of streamed content. And just as we've seen elsewhere in the world, and particularly in South Africa, but surprisingly across many countries in Africa, those names are starting to become the dominant providers of content. In some cases, supplanting the previous content providers, the local content, certainly local TV, etc. So why this is important is that that's got to come from somewhere. The infrastructure that makes that possible is the same infrastructure that makes the enterprise cloud services possible. In some cases, it's actually literally the same. So some of those providers actually use the providers on the first page for their infrastructure. But in some cases, they're dedicated stuff. And that's why I added the line at the bottom, which some people sometimes forget, and that is that the content delivery networks are an essential part of this. So everywhere that you go, that you deploy across infrastructure, that needs to be followed with certain other kinds of infrastructure. And in many ways, the content delivery networks are the matrix, the infrastructure that ensures this content actually gets out to consumers. Some of them are providing security, some of them are actually caching, some of them are just providing the glue that makes all of this work. But either way, Africa is already on the cloud. Most Africans have some access to some cloud service. I would be extremely surprised if there's anybody at all who has a mobile phone or any internet service who doesn't use at least one of these services. So our customers are out there, the infrastructure is required regardless. So what is the real opportunity? As we see it, and I think you've heard this mentioned a few times in this in the show, that data center capacity is completely out of line with other measures of the African continent. So we're 17% of the world's population, we have 13% of the mobile connections, we have 5% of the broadband connections, we have 4% of the 4G connections, and yet the data center capacity in Africa is 1% of the global total. So something's got to give. And what we see happening is a very rapid expansion of that number. And the right-hand graph is really just a sample to give you a sense. And what we see is a very sudden change in the demand for physical colocation infrastructure when you move from smaller generic colocation, as has been around for many years, and companies have been slowly outsourcing. That market is certainly growing, and it's growing linearly. But as soon as any kind of global cloud, any kind of edge for global cloud starts to appear, and particularly the core of the global cloud, suddenly the numbers shift. So between in the 5 years from 2016 to 2021, we went from essentially nothing to, you know, about 15 facilities that required substantial capacity of some sort to carry this cloud. And that's really based on primarily core deployments in one country and a couple of countries that have significant edge deployments. There are 54 countries. We have a long way to go. So we see this happening again and again and again across regions. And our whole model is built on the fact that we are targeting the regions where we expect it to happen. Of course, we have to guess right. That's a bit harder. But it's actually fairly obvious when you start to look at the structure of Africa where those hotspots are going to be. So we see a conservative 15% compound annual growth rate for data center infrastructure over the next few years. Every time we look at this, we think if that spike happens in one or more countries, those numbers actually are going to be small. And so that's really where we see the opportunity. So let's talk a little bit about the challenges of building the infrastructure for the cloud. So sometimes people think of the providers of colocation as being nothing more than landlords. We're a little bit more than landlords. Not many landlords keep the lights on 100% of the time. But really, when it comes down to site selection, and we have a very active program of purchasing property to build up a pool of available sites across the continent, just as any business that's going to be rolling out an infrastructure play, we have a pipeline that is essentially land. And that selection of that land comes down to all the same things that you do in the case of any property. It's location, location, location. What do you need? Power. I know we often, in South Africa, we've got into the habit of thinking that we have dreadful power. Guys, spend some time in a few other countries, and you'll be grateful. We don't have great power right now. We'd like to have 100% availability, but there's certainly countries where the number that gets quoted is the amount of time that the power is on, not the amount it's off. So power and grid and also generation of power are number one on the list when we start looking for locations. Climate, I'll talk a bit about climate now and the options we have for cooling, property law, regulation, etc., fiber and internet connectivity, and of course the regulations that go with that, and then there's a span of risks that any one of our larger customers tends to make longer and longer every time we have to respond to an RFP. There's another risk we have to comply and check and mitigate, etc. But essentially anything, flood, seismic, safety, political, any kind of risk that goes with the territory is really important to look at. If you're wondering where the pictures are, the Cape Town one should be obvious. That's our Deep River CPT1 facility. Bottom left-hand is our new Lagos Lost One facility, which is on the south side of Victoria Island, if you know where that is. And the right-hand one is a long-established hub of the entire East African cloud and internet ecosystem, which is our Nairobi NBO1 facility. So, what are we planning? Well, lots. So, here's what we have right now. We have a few locations in specific countries which we've started to build our core infrastructure. The circles represent our infrastructure. The diamonds are partners where we've either operating or working with a partner. So that's what we have right now. Essentially operating in three major regions, Southern Africa, East Africa, West Africa. We have plans for North Africa, and maybe I should just move on to the plans. So we have a whole lot more dots that are coming onto the map, and it's going to be starting with adding a new facility in Cape Town. So if anybody knows where Atlantic Hills is, a little bit north of the city, we're preparing to build there. And then a string of facilities across the continent in no particular order. Kigali in Rwanda, Kinshasa in the DRC, Accra in Ghana, that's fairly soon. Abidjan in Cote d'Ivoire, Dakar in Senegal, Cairo in Egypt, which is a northern hub, with some challenges, which I think those who are familiar with the markets will know. Casablanca, Morocco, and Tunis in Tunisia. Plus potentially others, but that's what we're expecting to spend money on. ADC has about $500 million in debt finance directly into our company as ADC rather than the group level, and that's what we're using to do these rollouts. What I didn't mention is that we are busy with expansions on every one of our existing facilities. So just looking at their size right now, for those who are not familiar with the terminology, we measure data centers in megawatts. There was a time in the dark ages when people used to talk about square meters and racks. That's a bit old-fashioned now because everybody measures things in megawatts now. We do count the racks as well. But essentially, the kind of data centers we're building, the kind of market we're addressing, is the kind of 1 to 2 megawatt and up type facilities. So our partner facility at Lome is actually quite small, and it's kind of below the level that we would normally build. But the Lagos facility, we've built out the initial phase, but we're adding about 10, that up to about 10 megawatts initially. Nairobi, for those who are familiar, it's a well-known site there. We've got an expansion plan there up to 15 megawatts. Samrand, which is the data center we acquired from Standard Bank, for those who may be familiar, is essentially full, and we're expanding it. So that's going up to about 30 megawatts. If you want to see what a big data center construction site looks like, ask us. We'll show you. Our Midrand facility, which is really our flagship at the moment, is a 15-megawatt facility that's potential to expand around the site to about 45, and the Deep River site, we're busy right now doubling its size. And all of those facilities are, if you like, this is the run rate business that we have before we start all those other builds. However, if you just do the sums, and I haven't put you all the numbers on the slides, but I'm just going to add them all up for you. If you add up all the numbers of what we have about 170 acres of land. We are targeting a build that reaches about a bit over 300 megawatts in the next few years. We have about 37 megawatts in active construction right now. We have a live operational 24 megawatts, and we'll be operating in 9 countries. Essentially, the 9 countries includes the ones where the land is, and we're starting to build. So that might give you a sense of scale. We haven't compared ourselves recently to anybody else, but I don't think there's anybody that is close to this in terms of the sheer spread and scale. We're not necessarily the biggest in each country, and we're not necessarily trying to be. We're certainly trying to be the best. So, more challenges. It's It's interesting because people, I suppose it's more an international view, but there's this tendency to kind of think of Africa as one place. And so you, when you think of Africa, you kind of summarize it down, yeah, I know the climate in Africa, you know, it's kind of hot and dry and it's the savannah, right? Completely not true if you're looking at the build. So when we look at standardized builds, and I'll show you a bit of that now, and we're going to put down a standardized build, we're going to try and build a standard data center that works in the high, dry conditions of Nairobi, but will also work in the kind of wet, hot conditions in Lagos. And somehow we've got to find a way to try and standardize our build so that we can support a relatively standard build with that. The second thing which is interesting, and I hunted for this because it's not that easy to find, we all know that there's a water problem in Africa, but this is the best picture I found to show us just how severe that is. Even in tropical, wet tropical areas in Africa, there is an actual shortage of water, particularly for industrial purposes. So one of our principles is no water. We do not use water. We have a zero water target. And in some cases, we've actually achieved a literal zero water because we've generated water. If you remember some years back, the drought in Cape Town, we essentially took ourselves off-grid and started condensing our own water on site. But essentially, in our operations, we use essentially no water for cooling. Right, so this is not a comprehensive design specification. I'll just give you a sense of where we are with our design. Our head of development, is every time we ask him about a standard design, says, no, we adapt it every time. So it gets better every time. But this is the real basis of where we are. And obviously, we're starting to build at scale. We're starting to build hyperscale-type data centers, and therefore, you know, these are the things that would apply to anybody who's trying to do this across the continent. So firstly, standardizing a best practice design. And you've kind of got to keep ahead of the curve there because our customers, including, you know, major financial institutions, large multinationals, particularly the hyperscale cloud providers, they track that best practice. So they tend to set the targets for you. So one of the favorite things that's been tracked over the last few years, of course, is PUE, Power Usage Effectiveness. It's been dropping nicely over the years. That's the Uptime Institute survey. In the Uptime Institute's words, it's not really an issue anymore because kind of everybody's about there or thereabout. We're not going to see a sudden drop in the PUE because actually we're kind of reaching some real limit. And actually, we're kind of getting to a point where it's not as important as some of the other design parameters. So it's particularly important, as some of the players in Europe have seen recently, you know, you can work on your PUE as much as you like, but if you do not have enough cooling, you have a much bigger problem. So you might want to back off on the PUE a little bit so that you have enough cooling. So it's that kind of compromise we're starting to reach. But again, global best practice, staying at the right there. We built a tier 3. We do have one tier 4 data center currently in Samran, but we built a tier 3. We don't necessarily certify because actually our designs are built to 5.9s. We have our own methodology, so do our customers, of evaluating our designs. So we don't necessarily certify with any particular provider, but we build to a concurrently maintainable tier 3. Obviously, we meet current global standards. Those can vary, but across the, you know, in various parts of what we do. Number one, we meet our customer requirements. What I said earlier about being able to build to suit, the bigger the customer, the more you build to suit. And we have a range of products where we can either, you know, offer standard colocation, or we can essentially provide an environment which is tailored, or we can go all the way to essentially building or taking a shell and building it to suit the customer exactly. Always comply with local regulations. That gets interesting when you're dealing with the range of countries that we're dealing with. We have at least three or four fundamentally different legal systems that we have to deal with. All you have to do is work in Anglophone West Africa and Francophone West Africa, as we've been doing, and cross the borders, and suddenly you find yourself with a completely different approach to how law works, never mind the actual regulations. Sustainability goals, I'll talk a bit about now, and then modularity. And there's a picture. Those pictures come from our most recent build in Midrand, how to build a modular data center so that you can repeat it and so that you can scale it and so you don't spend all the money up front. And then just a few comments there about, you know, things like edge green building. That's a new standard that we are going to be applying from now, is the edge green building standards we're looking to certify. And also, you know, obviously, as I've mentioned, the zero water. So there's what it looks like when you build it. This is our 10 megawatt facility in Midrand, about 15 months build. And just for those who are interested in the timing of this, it more or less built right the way through the lockdown periods. So a very interesting and challenging time, I think globally, but particularly for us in the infrastructure business, because we had rapidly increasing demand at the same time as having to operate in very, very difficult circumstances where we had hundreds of people on site under level 4 restrictions in South Africa. But that's the outcome. The data halls there are not quite as empty as they look in the picture there, but feel free to come and have a look anytime. So operationally, I'm going to try and just gloss over the next few slides, because really this is now housekeeping in a sense. It's often when we talk about the tier three-ness or the concurrent maintainability of data centers as being the measure. Very often in people's minds, they're thinking about a tier three build and not a tier three operation. Tier three operations mean that you have to be able to actually work with a system that is sufficiently concurrently maintainable, but you have to maintain it. And you have to have physically, in many cases, you know, it's not absolutely necessary to have 24/7 on-site support, but we do at all of our facilities. Same for support for customers. The whole maintenance philosophy has to be built around tier three, as you probably realize. Very significant requirements in terms of vendor support, not only from the OEMs, but also in terms of the increasing number of specialist providers, or if you like, specialist providers coming into Africa who are in the business of facilities operation. There are a lot more players like that in other continents. We haven't seen many of them here, and they're starting to come in, starting to really specialize in data center operations here, which is good for us. Spares holdings and all the things that go with that, coordinating with local utilities, and then physical security, which is, if you looked at the legs of what I said we sell to our customers, which is reliability, security, and connectivity, the security really matters. And if you've ever dealt with a bank or financial services, you'll know that this is really important. So what standards do we apply? The list down the side is essentially also housekeeping. Any one of our larger customers has a list of requirements. I'll just highlight a couple of them. Increasingly, we see environmental, 14001. We certainly see a demand for information security. Remember, we're not a provider of IT services. None of the customer's data touches our systems, but we need 27001 certification because we have their names in the database. Literally, we need to secure our own IT. Health and safety, tremendously important. Global customers, really, really high on the list, and I think for anybody who's built infrastructure in Africa, you'll know that that's an interesting challenge. Closing the gap between an expectation from a global customer and the reality on the ground when you're building in an African environment. And you know, we've honed this. We've built very comprehensive systems, particularly in the builds that we've done now in South Africa. We've repeated to use those systems now in Nigeria. We'll keep using those health and safety frameworks and oversight of health and safety. And then the other one, which I think is sometimes not that obvious, PCI DSS, that's the physical security certification. Basically, the simple way of looking at that is if you don't have that, no one who runs credit cards, any kind of financial transactions is going to come near your facility if you can't provide that up front. So there are a few things here which are tickets to the game. This is already actually, you know, a market which is challenging to enter, but if you don't have those things, you almost can't sell. So I'm going to talk very briefly, I'm not doing on time, I'm going to talk briefly about some sustainability. Again, I like these pictures of Africa because they really give you a flavor of what we're dealing with without having to go into tables of numbers. So right-hand side, that's the current renewable grid power in Africa. It's very surprising. It's very surprising if you don't know Africa. Yeah, we know that South Africa is really down the low side. Low, by the way, being sort of 10% in South Africa. And we know that there are other countries like Nigeria where that's, you know, it's an oil economy, so clearly it's not very renewable. But it is quite surprising to know that the Congo is majority, DRC, and both DRC and Congo-Brazzaville are very, very high percentage renewable energy because they use mostly hydro. And you'll see the same in Kenya. So very interesting balance there. But you cannot read that picture without looking at the little table on the bottom left-hand corner. So if you stand back and you look at Africa as a continent, you'll find that actually we're hopeless when it comes to renewable energy, because the vast majority of the energy is actually used in two or three markets. And they're markets that are coal-based and oil-based and hopelessly non-renewable. So that's actually the challenge we have. We don't have a specific challenge with renewable energy in, for example, Kenya. We're sitting at about 80% renewable on the grid. We've added our own solar to that, so we're actually kind of approaching 90% in Kenya. Okay, so potential, this I didn't put an attribution here, I must just add the source here, but this is a study which was done on where can you get solar PV and wind to work in Africa, and it turns out lots of places. So if you just compare the two graphs, or two sets of pictures, you'll see that many of the places where we have lack of renewables, wind and solar will do it. And particularly South Africa, I think we're very conscious of that right now. So every man and his dog is currently building solar in South Africa, including us. So this is our renewable energy approach. We are heading towards carbon neutrality. We have some goals there. We haven't announced the specific goals, but we're tracking our customers' goals, which are in the next five years or so. Most of our customers have a carbon neutrality goal, and we're tracking to that. We've done embedded solar on our own sites. So that's what I gave the examples there. That's Joburg and Nairobi you're looking at there. And then we've just recently awarded a 20 megawatt renewable energy project, which is going to be built in the Free State. You might say, why the Free State? Well, it's where the sun shines. But importantly, it's leveraging the change in regulation in South Africa, which enables us to wheel across the grid. So we're working very closely, obviously with Eskom, but also with the local utilities, because everybody's itching to get the wheeling model working in South Africa so that we can do it. And to answer the obvious question, you know, is this expensive? The answer is no, it's cheap. Currently, solar PV is, over a 20-year period, this is typical lifespan of a build, way cheaper than anything you can get for costing an Eskom tariff. So, I want to talk a little bit about the internet. I'm probably now at time. So when we talk about ecosystems, we talk about where data centers fit in the cloud ecosystem. This is as fundamental as electricity. If you're not the hub of the internet and people aren't connected to you, you're not going to be part of the cloud. So the good news is that despite what you might think, you know, there aren't one or two dominant IXPs on the continent. Yes, there's some big ones. But the reality is that content is local. The principles we follow are local regulation, and just please note, I mean, anybody here from any North African country, please note, local regulation is actually the first key, sort it out, and then we can have open peering and access and communications between those that need to communicate. Getting the traffic local, getting the peering local, and the three stages identified by the Internet Society are you go from kind of basically having an internet exchange that is there to carry local traffic or local content, to bringing regional content in together, and to then moving all the international content into a market. And there are a few tricks to make that work. So you'll see a few labeled there, some of the ones that we're working with. Our policy as ADC is every single one of our facilities has at least one IXP, and in general we are working with the communities because traffic is local, content is local. We have no more interest in, you know, pushing traffic from, say, South Africa to Nigeria than pushing it from London to Nigeria. From Nigeria's perspective, it needs to be in Nigeria. So that's our ecosystem. I'm not going to go through all of that, but just kind of run along the bottom. There are our partner IXPs. You'll notice there, you know, the local associations in each country. We can also, in South Africa, offer remote peering into the largest, which is the NAP Africa Internet Exchange in its various sites. Plus, you know, an ecosystem that looks like this across every one of our environments, and as we go into an environment, we build it out. So I'm not going to go through the detail here. I just wanted to make a comment about skills and capabilities. There was a whole discussion this morning about skills. The only point I'd like to make about it is, you know, it's very trite, but it's very true. You need to think global and act local. Global experience combined with local knowledge. We have some true experts in their fields that have come into our organization from with many years of global experience, which is then combined with our local people on the ground. 99% of our staff in any country are local. We have a program of obviously of training those staffs, and we're looking at some of the discussions earlier with about the ADCA about the possibilities of broader initiatives in the industry to get training, but we want to continue that very much local people in everything. And the rest of those are kind of things which we found as essential to running the operation. So that is everything I have to say. I don't know if there's any time for questions, and of course you may want lunch, but I will take any questions that there are. Thank you.
Just a question on the first slide you had.
Yeah.
In terms of the fabric. So I presume you've come up with some model or something that's going to be a bit different than what we traditionally used to in the data center environment of interconnecting. Do you maybe want to expand on that?
Or? So, I mean, I'm going to make a comment which I think Michelle from Terraco had made as well, is that we don't necessarily invent everything new. We are using best practice. What we're finding is that the connectivity environments in data centers are not the old-fashioned plug-in across connect cable. That world is moving. And increasingly, what customers are looking for is a nice, easy way to get an on-ramp onto the cloud. They want multiple options for different cloud providers. They might want even different providers of the connectivity to the cloud. They obviously want to get to the multiple internet exchanges. In many cases, we're seeing a demand for local, what we'd like to sort of describe as like metro cross-connects. Like you've got two data centers. It's very common in developed markets. I mean, in data centers in a sort of cluster in the UK, for example, you wouldn't say, where am I going to get a carrier to get from across the road? These are things which are built into the ecosystem. So yes, it's very much around building that. I want to tell more about it now because we could probably announce it, and our head of products is looking at me, so we'll announce it properly. But that's essentially what it is. It's about bringing some automation, bringing some flexibility, and even to the point of certain kinds of providers which we're partnering with, which would bring huge flexibility. Software-defined network access, etc. So beyond just the existing stuff that you have. More questions? Great. Thank you.
To our sponsors and partners, thank you for participating.